Hi, I'm Susan Taylor with Scripps Health in San Diego, California. How many times have you said, oh, my aching back? You turn the wrong way, you get pain. You lift up a bag of groceries, maybe you're playing tennis or baseball, and boom, there it is. Pain in the muscle, pain down your spine. Back pain affects 8 out of 10 people at some point during their lifetime. Here to talk about minimally invasive back surgery is Dr. Robert Eastlack. He's an orthopedic surgeon with the Scripps Clinic Medical Group in La Jolla, California. Thanks so much for being with us, doctor.
Happy to be here.
So why is back pain so common?
Well, the spine's a complicated part of your body. It is foundational to all of the movement that you do. It supports your torso and is a connection for your arms and legs. So between that and all the various muscles around it and the joints within it, it's a source of injury and aging.
So what causes back pain?
Well, there are many things that can cause it. As you'll see in this model, there are many joints. There are discs that you see all the way up. There are facet joints on the back. And there are a myriad of muscles that sit on the back of the spine and in the front to help it move. All of those structures, in addition to what they do to the nerves that you see exiting here, can be injured or bothered through the process of injury or aging.
But in most cases, back pain does go away by itself. Over what period of time?
Most back pain episodes will, on average, go through about 4 to 6 weeks. And by that time, they'll typically fade away. So while they can start and be quite severe, the vast majority will fade away on their own.
How would you treat that back pain, though, during those 4 to 6 weeks?
So initially, many of the episodes are quite severe, and we use icing and heat and anti-inflammatory medications or Tylenol, things like that, that are relatively mild. Occasionally, a wrap or a brace can help. But for the most part, the first few days are just time you get through it using those modalities, and then you try to get back on the horse and gently return to regular activities as you fill up to it, knowing that you're looking at a 4 to 6 week horizon on average.
And so what happens if it doesn't go away during that 4 to 6 week period?
So if the pain persists, and particularly if it's more severe beyond the first few days where you can't even mobilize or get up and walk, then it's time to see somebody.
And what about if you have weakness or numbness, or you're weak in the limbs? What do you do? At what point do you go see a doctor about that?
Definitely, if you have neurologic symptoms of concern, which include what you said, weakness, numbness, bowel or bladder changes can actually happen if the wrong nerves are squeezed, and fevers or chills that are potentially a representation of something more sinister. Those are reasons to go to the emergency room, urgent care, or make a more urgent visit with your doctor.
And so talk about spine shifting. What is that?
Spine shifting is generally a process of the joints not holding things together as they're supposed to. That can be, as you see in the model, the discs can fade away, they can collapse, and without a disc that's there to hold things together, or the facet joints in the back that are more like finger or knee joints, they have cartilage and joint fluid. As those joints age, if they become less competent, then you can get shifting of the vertebra to the side or to the front. And if those joints move too much, they pinch these yellow structures you see here, the nerves as they come out or travel through the spinal canal. And then if the muscles on the back aren't working well, you can get similar shifting and you can develop deformities where more of the spine takes a shape of hunching over or a twist in the back that you'll have heard called scoliosis.
And is there a genetic component to this? Let's say your parents had this. Are you more likely to have it?
The arthritic processes or degenerative processes, as we term them in the spine, are very much genetic. About 75% of the influence is genetic in its origin. While that said, there are still environmental influences, heavy lifting for a long period of one's life or significant activities like that can push it a little farther, a little faster.
And talk about advancements in back surgery, because the technology has changed dramatically over the past 20 years.
Decades ago, spine surgery was quite crude, very big open surgeries with a lot of blood loss that really made it untenable, particularly in the aged population. But minimally invasive has been about less destructive nature of the surgery on the way to the spine. So it's things like using tubes to dilate through muscle. And now we can even do reconstructive or spine fusion type of procedures where the spine has shifted and we need to put it back where it belongs to protect the nerves. Now we can do without disrupting all of the muscle tissue that surrounds the spine and provides structural support to the trunk. And that's been a great avenue for us to treat the patients that are over 65 or 70. And now we can do that without the same level of complication or risk for our elderly patients.
And what is spinal fusion exactly?
A spinal fusion is where we connect one bone with the other. And we're typically doing that when the joints have lost hold. If a disc has evaporated or collapsed and the vertebral bones are shifting, as I showed you in the model, if they shift, they pinch the nerves. And when they shift, we want to put them back where they belong to give safe harbor to the nerves. When we do that, because the joints are no longer doing what they're supposed to do, we have to overcome that by connecting one bone to the other through holding them together and letting those bones fuse or grow together.
And what's the downtime for that kind of surgery?
The downtime depends on how much we do, but typically, and largely because of what we've gained from minimally invasive approaches, patients are up walking a few hours after surgery and typically can go home the next day after the vast majority of those types of even larger fusion operations.
So talk a little bit more in detail about minimally invasive back surgery. What exactly is that?
There's a variety of ways to do it. We do primarily two things in spine surgery. We are taking pressure off nerves that are squeezed or spinal cord neural tissue that's squeezed. And on the other side, we reconstruct the spine. We fuse it. We put disc replacements in. We're doing something to overcome the failure of the joints within the spinal column that sit around the nerves. Minimally invasive can be used in both settings. On the taking pressure off nerve side, we do things like endoscopy, which is using scopes like you might see a joint surgeon use in the knee or the shoulder. So there's a camera that goes in a small portal and another portal that we use to do some of the work inside. We use small tubes that go down to the point that we need to work in, and we use high-powered microscopes to see down these long tubes and do little work with tiny tools, but with great visualization and illumination, so that we're not destroying all the tissue that surrounds the spine on the way to get the job done.
How is this different from major back surgery?
The major back surgery, as we would historically think about it, is a long, open exposure where we're essentially going through the skin, we're taking the muscle off the spine so that we can see everything we want to see on the spinal column. And the spinal column surrounds the nerves. So we're going through the spinal column to get to the nerves. And we're doing that in a way that's typically with our visualization through eyes or glasses that we wear that have some magnification. But there's a pathway to get to the spine that requires a fairly large opening in the back or the belly or in the neck, in the front of the back. When we talk about minimally invasive, we're working through very small holes. And we're using image guidance, which is fancy X-ray technology or intraoperative CAT scans to see the underlying anatomy. And then we're targeting it through small holes or portals with, again, sometimes our scope equipment, sometimes operating microscope, but things that allow us to see very deep in the body through small holes. So the surrounding damage is avoided. So we could still do major surgery, if you will, but the damage getting there is significantly lessened.
And so the downtime of minimally invasive back surgery versus traditional back surgery?
The change has been fairly dramatic. When I started, for instance, several decades ago, an open surgery that was more traditional would have a patient in the hospital in bed for 5 to 7 days. And they may be very slow to get out of bed, if at all, and they might go to rehab or a skilled nursing facility after that for quite a while. The advent of minimally invasive surgery has allowed us to do surgeries, big and small, and have people out of bed the same day. with the minimally invasive surgeries where we're taking pressure off nerves. Now we can get people home the same day. So they're mostly outpatient surgeries. When we do reconstructive or fusion surgeries, people can go home the same day or the next day. And even the bigger deformity surgeries, which historically have been very big open surgeries and might be hospitalized from 10 to 14 days, those people can go home in 2 to 3 days.
And how soon are you back to your normal life in terms of running or swimming or playing golf, tennis, or playing with the grandkids?
That comes still in some phases. Your ability to, say, walk or hike or do light, low impact activities that don't require a lot of torque, bending, twisting, or lifting, you can do right away. There's some endurance challenges even with minimally invasive surgery, because surgery still takes some energy expenditure out of you to heal. And so while you can go walk a mile, you may not walk 5 miles a few days after surgery. The bending, lifting, and twisting is still restricted, because when we do minimally invasive surgery, we're still intending to, say, fuse a segment of the spine. And that biologic process has a timeline that is still going to require several months to be accomplished. The minimally invasive part of it doesn't accelerate the healing of the bone-to-bone connection. It just simply allows the surrounding envelope to feel better faster, so that you can get back on the light activity horse pretty quickly.
And the minimally invasive back surgery you use to treat spinal stenosis, what is that?
Spinal stenosis, which is narrowing of the spaces for the nerves, and that can be within the spinal canal. It can be where the nerve roots exit the spine. That phenomenon of stenosis really is generally treated quite well with minimally invasive approaches to simply root out some of the arthritic overgrowth that occurs and creates that narrowing. So we're using these microscopes and tubes to go down and chip away, if you will, at little bits of arthritic tissue that's overgrown its welcome. It's enlarged to the point where it's squeezing nerves. And we can do that without disrupting the spinal structure or its function.
So, doctor, what advice would you give to folks to help take care of their back?
Probably the single most important thing to do is maintain the muscle structural support. It's normal with aging for muscles to atrophy. And it's not gender biased. It hits men, it hits women. But when the muscles start to wither with age, they no longer hold those many vertebrae together. And as I showed you before, there's lots of vertebrae, 28 vertebrae. And particularly in the lumbar spine, you have very strong little muscles that sit on the back of the spine, and they intervene. They go between one vertebra and another, maybe two vertebrae. They're very short muscle fibers, very strong. And when they wither, you get slop between those vertebrae. And then the joints deteriorate more rapidly. And if they're arthritic, they hurt more. So the single most important thing to do is to maintain those muscles, which doesn't happen without exercise and core strengthening. So doing core strengthening in one's life through yoga or Pilates or your own program is really critical to keep the back as healthy as it can be.
Are there any preventive steps that you can take to preserve your back?
Other preventative approaches are to maintain body weight in some reasonable levels. The excessive body weight can demand a lot of those joints, and eventually they'll wear out. Eating a reasonably good, modest diet is also good. The inflammatory conditions that come from diets that are more inflammatory in their nature can cause some trouble for the joints of the spine. Smoking or nicotine has some disastrous effects for the blood flow to some of the tissues in the spine, particularly the discs. And the discs between the vertebrae are not very vascular. They have poor blood flow in general, and they struggle with nutritional support. And if you're clamping down on those vessels that bring nutritional support through nicotine and smoking, then they will suffer a more rapid decline and degeneration.
Any final thoughts, doctor?
Get out there and exercise. If you are overweight, try to lose weight. If you smoke or use nicotine, remember that hurts your back long term, and it's better to get rid of it. Eat well. Don't overdo it on an unhealthy diet. Do core strengthening routinely. You don't have to do it every day, but try to make it a maintenance routine in your life a few days a week. core means abdomen and back muscles. And if you have a problem that persists, or you have any of those tough symptoms of weakness or numbness or something more concerning, we have a great team at Scripps with wonderful technology to help you in a variety of ways.
Doctor, thanks so much for being with us. We appreciate you taking the time.
Thank you very much.
If you'd like more information about minimally invasive back surgery, just click on the link or go to scripps.org/videos. Want more critical information about your health? Please subscribe to our Scripps Health YouTube channel and follow us on social media at Scripps Health. At Scripps, we're here for good. I'm Susan Taylor. Thanks for joining us.